Wolfenstein Youngblood is probably the least necessary Wolfenstein title since Spear of Destiny. It's a spin-off title in every way, tangential to the current series' main plot, tangential to the tone it was trying to build, and tangential to the reasons I played the main games mechanically. Youngblood is, like Fallout 76, a strange and experimental deviation from the source material's structure without really a clear audience in mind. Wolfenstein Youngblood is only worthwhile on its own terms alone, as an irreverent co-op shooter whose aim is not so much to kill Nazis as to kill time. It's a fun game to play with a friend, less of a commitment than something like Destiny, less plot-driven than Gears of War, more visually striking and artistic than something like Dead Space 3. If you're considering trying it as a single-player companion campaign to the New Order and the New Colossus, don't. It's mechanically balanced around co-op to the point where single-player is simply not enjoyable. Youngblood is the most combat-heavy game of all the newer line. The sheer volume of enemies rivals good old Wolfenstein 3D. It pretty much requires a real human mind and real human reflexes in the player 2 slot. The AI simply isn't remotely aggressive enough to replace the way a human approaches an arena full of multivarious Nazis and murder bots. You can turn the difficulty down, but that just makes them toothless, turns the massive fire hose of enemy pressure into a puddle of bullet sponges to wade through on your way to the next quest objective. It is either too hard or too easy for a single player. I simply haven't found any solution that works, besides conning a friend into playing it with you. Luckily, I had such a friend, and we pushed through for a fairly completionist playthrough of the game in its full co-op glory. Before I get into any of my nitpicks and criticisms, I want to say this. We had fun. We drank a lot of beers, we told a lot of jokes, we enjoyed hanging out in the game space and doing the game things long enough to run out of beer. It wasn't wasted time. Without that social element to bypass the monotonous elements of the game, I might not have felt that way about it at all. If you're trying to give Wolfenstein Youngblood your best, most honest attempt to have fun with it and meet it in the middle, then you'll want to treat it less like a story-driven game, like New Order or New Colossus, less like a skill-driven game, like the DOS Wolfensteins, and more in keeping with a contemporary corporate philosophy of games that sees them as a space to socially inhabit, perform activities, and sometimes spend money in, like a hyper-violent, thematically focused Dave & Buster's. Youngblood isn't in competition with itself so much as it's in competition with Fortnite and Destiny 2 as places where the youths go to spend their lunch Venmos. Now, the cash shop in Youngblood is completely optional, and you can get most of the things just by playing a lot, but the game's menus are constantly reminding you that a little money goes a long way towards impressing your friends and smashing the state. Combined with the overwhelmingly arcade-focused mechanical experience, the game is just very difficult to take seriously in any way. Doesn't ever much ask you to, but for me, the new Wolfensteins are built on an intricate balance of humanistic dialogue and inhuman video game violence. The New Order was pretty much a magical realist shooter, one of the first big-budget games with that sort of vibe, which the new Colossus somewhat abandoned in favor of a more pulp-punk attitude. Youngblood takes that pulp much, much further, until stylistic camp is almost all that's left. The action-comedy tone is partly a function of the setting. It is 1980, we've skipped right over whatever the third mainline Wolfenstein is going to be about and assume that BJ's American Revolution worked, but that the Nazis still control Europe. His daughters, the twins that hadn't even been born yet when last we left them, have grown up both fierce and goofy. They're the glue that holds the experience together, functioning in the same one-liner-driven, perpetually joking way that characters like Duke Nukem and Kate Archer used to. Jess and Soph take on Paris neighborhood by neighborhood in a kind of limited open-world format in a bid to find their missing dad. There's little plot. Ambient dialogue between the two of them is the broad majority of the dialogue in the game. So being irrepressible goofballs really works in that way. Player 1 and 2 are friends, just trying to kill some Nazis and have a good time, and so are Jess and Soph. The four of you are tied together with riffs, jokes, and snorting laughter. In some ways, the dynamic between Jess and Soph feels like a long-lost, gender-swapped Ben Affleck and Matt Damon 90s movie. They've just got that same kind of manic screwball energy to them. I like them. They're fun. That affability is kind of the problem, though. The Blazkowicz we last left off is weary of violence, and he's all weighed down with a seemingly infinite war that he's fought. It's not just that this is the twins' first war, it's that it never really is a war to them. It's a game to them as much as it is to you. Or, alternatively, pulp adventure. The twins are constantly making reference to Arthur and Kenneth, a Hardy Boys-like duo who solve crimes primarily with Daring Do. It's an amusing juxtaposition to have them heroically style themselves after a couple of storybook innocents, considering that what they're doing is much more serious. It's never serious for them, though, so it can never be serious for the player, which is in sharp contrast to the games that came before. Youngblood simply doesn't paint in an emotional palette outside of neon. Not that there are many chances for it to. There's plot at the beginning and plot at the end, but the vast majority of the game is simply choosing which of the three neighborhoods you'd like to complete a quest objective in and hunt for coins and collectibles. The world-building choices that the game uses to paint the background setting are sloppy and odd, like having Grace Walker run the newly formed FBI. I get that they're trying to suggest that the institution would take on a different character with her at the helm, but still, there wasn't a whole lot more that Grace hated than blind institutionalism, making it a tremendously awkward fit for her to, you know, lead the FBI. It feels like no one thought it through besides the wouldn't it be funny if element. Grace's daughter is the on-the-comms mission support character, and she's fine, totally adequate in the role, but there's not a whole lot about her that really ties her to Grace, either by adopting Grace's fiery distrust and anarchistic philosophy or rebelling against it. Instead, Abby is plucky and smart. Fine qualities in a sidekick, but also anonymously standard qualities. Everyone's been reduced to their most basic archetypes of character and then shuffled around, like on any It Was All a Dream novelty sitcom episode that messes around with the timeline and imagines the characters old or in different marriages or on the moon or whatever. I'll happily tolerate that for 22 minutes. 22 hours is a big ask. The linear campaigns of the previous games were focused on arenas and set-piece battles with specific, choreographed battle progressions. Each time you play the previous campaigns, the encounters have the same pacing, the same tone, the same enemy composition. Youngblood is much more procedural, filling the arenas with a rotating variety of enemies and renewable chests filled with upgrade coins. It also pretty much ditches the previous game's light stealth gameplay. Commanders still summon reinforcements, but killing commanders is no longer the general goal of any encounter zone. Instead, it's shoot, then loot, then open a two-person door that prevents you from carrying special heavy weapons into the next arena, neighborhood, or sewer maze. So, in one way, it has technically the longest playtime of any Wolfenstein title in the modern era, but it's also the most monotonous and indistinct in its encounters. The real boss fights are reserved for the assaults on the brother computer strongholds, which are sectioned off as instance raid events. What makes it a raid if you're still only two players? A total lack of save points. These climactic dungeon levels can take up to an hour, and if you wipe on the final boss, it's back to the beginning with you. With the addition of one intense, far-reaching penalty. Any ammunition you use stays used. If you wipe, it's not only possible but likely that you simply won't have the resources to mount another attempt immediately. The massive, constant volume of enemies is proportionally staggered to the amount of ammo they drop, so it may take 50 bullets to bring down a dude, but they only yield 15 to 25 ammo on death, forcing you to scrounge and swap weapons constantly. Weapons also have a power curve, becoming significantly more powerful after being upgraded in the late hours of the game. And one of the brother raids, Nate and I got to the last room and got absolutely worked by a giant death robot. We used all of our ammo and died in a fight that lasted well over 10 minutes before we were uselessly plinking it with pistol bullets and it lasered us both. It was hours later before we tried again, doing a whole bunch of indistinct side missions in the meantime to score coins to upgrade our guns. It's an interesting enough process. Each gun has different upgrade manufacturers, which change things like the firing rate, in addition to simple numbers boosts. If you use all of a single manufacturer's upgrades, you get more bonuses, but a less rounded weapon. For some of the basic fully auto weapons, the differences aren't huge, but the customization is substantial when it comes to special weapons like the laser rifle and diesel thrower. I dumped 6 hours worth of coin collection into making the laser rifle charge up a massively powerful single shot. If you miss, that's bad. Luckily, the giant death robots are about the size and weight of the broadside of a barn. What took Nate and I 10 minutes before, I downed in 3 charged shots. It was over in seconds, to the point of being an anticlimax after how badly we had lost the other time we tried to accomplish the raid. Which is to say, all the level scaling and carefully controlled rates of ammunition and coin collection and expenditure are anything but natural feeling. There is an inherent house advantage to any of the numbers, and when you go beyond the bracket for damage that the game's put you in, it feels immediately broken the opposite direction. If you time the content wrong, it can be the difference between a 10-minute fight and a 30-second fight. This mostly applies to the bosses, though. The level scaling makes it so that the upgrades are necessary to keep up with the advancing enemy levels, but do little to make killing them any faster or really more exciting. The pace of combat is essentially the same from hour 1 to hour 30, it's just that the health bars have doubled. The power curve, outside of some notable exceptions like the Laserkraftwerk, is less of a curve and more fully just a hamster wheel. So you can play the content in any order, there's no wrong way to do it, theoretically. But neither, then, is there really any right way to do it. No particular pattern that's any more rewarding than checklisting and grinding until the numbers are high enough to beat the final raid. The linear campaign structure of the previous games is what made them unique on the market, and unique in their storytelling. Each moment and each murder was crafted so specifically to its context that the joy in replaying the game was to re-experience each of those moments in sequence, like rewatching a favorite movie. Youngblood is technically different every time you play it, but functionally the same no matter what hour of the game you're playing. For me, this is the biggest disappointment. I'll never replay Youngblood because the core loop is replaying the game, over and over, in those same three neighborhoods. What's particularly interesting about Youngblood is that a lot of its level design was done by the same people that worked on Dishonored 2, one of the most architecturally beautiful games in years. It shows. I complain about the same three neighborhoods because, in completing the whole game, I am tired of them, but the sense of discovery and the detail of scenery the first few times around does make a huge positive impression. The neighborhoods are intensely urban, with alleyways, sewers, and rooftops that interconnect in cleverly hidden ways. The combat is really just an obstacle in the way of ducking down into the tiniest nooks and crannies of the level and finding some reward already hidden there for you. Mechanical pacing is the problem here. In Dishonored, as more or less an immersive sim, each roomful of enemies was a discrete encounter. The items you got from exploration and the avoidance value of side routes were meaningful. Youngblood stealth is difficult to maintain for more than 30 seconds at a time because of the density of enemies. There is always someone to see you, and they're not really designed with patrol patterns in mind that you can easily avoid. When the fight begins, it involves everyone within about a city block's radius and continues until all of them are dead. You aren't free to explore until the fighting is over, but then the exploration isn't especially purposeful if it didn't help you avoid or excel at the combat. The exploration rewards are mostly in the form of coins and chests and ammunition bundles that allow you to stock up for the raids, over and above the regular attrition of ammo from just going about your business. Again, this is the fundamental experiential difference between Youngblood and the other machine games Wolfensteins. In those campaigns, I was always thinking about where I was and why. In Youngblood, I was in a perpetual hunt for extremely gradual numeric boosts. Even the aesthetic gorgeousness of some of the levels do nothing to alleviate my fundamental disconnection from the context of what I'm doing, who I'm supposed to be. The three brother raids are significantly different in tone and setting, from a deep industrial lab to a lushly wood-paneled research university, but the core gameplay is still monotonous and makes the combat feel even more chore-like when the thrills of shooting pale in comparison to the little serotonin hit of finding a hidden box in a locked room. Mechanical pacing of Dishonored allows for harmony between combat and exploration, blurs the lines between the two, keeps the pressure on no matter which activity is taking immediate priority. Youngblood's mechanical pacing keeps combat and exploration bisected, to the benefit of neither. If you don't like the Dishonored comparison, consider how doomed it its arenas. The extreme fast pace of combat and its mandate to never stop moving means the player familiarizes themselves with almost the entire space while combat is ongoing, so that in the quiet moments between battles, you can do more intensive secret hunting with an understanding of what's out of place in a level already established. Youngblood's inherited mechanics from New Colossus mean that sprinting all over the place like Doom is just a surefire way to die. No, the space is designed with co-op coordination in mind, chokeholds and kill zones that mean strategically utilizing different parts of an area map instead of homicidally sprinting through all of it. At the end of the fight in Youngblood, you know your area, but that whole process of learning the dimensions of the greater space takes place mostly after the killing is done. It feels a little sterile and boring at that point, in a way that the Doom 2016 and Dishonored 2 never were, even though those games have diametrically opposed game design philosophies. The way Wolfenstein games try to establish a unique mechanical identity in the pacing and feel of combat over other similar games has always been its hardest struggle. Youngblood doesn't seem like it even bothered to put up a fight. It simply copied the New Colossus' fast and aggressive damage system, doubled the enemies, doubled the players to compensate, and called it good. It feels artless, which makes the art harder to appreciate when you find it. What Dishonored 2 is really peerless at and has carried over to Youngblood is a knack for richly detailed, casually believable interiors. None of the layouts are realistic in any way. They're all built around cover and attack pathways instead of actual civic utility. All the better for the game that way, because the detail and skill that went into those environments perfectly sets the intended mood anyway. Youngblood's aesthetic is much stronger and its art direction more intricate than any of the DLCs for the New Colossus. Oddly, the way you experience the neighborhoods and hunt for secrets in them feels very in keeping with the 2009 Wolfenstein reboot. The same feeling of emptiness without any civilian life in the city, the same mix of dread and resolve when your objective is clear on the other side of town. Youngblood's 1980 fascist retrofuture allows for a lot more creativity, too, than the vaguely paranormal 1945 of the previous reboot. In the 1960-61 of The New Colossus, the kind of monolithic royal brutalism on display was a big part of setting the scene, creating a whole mood out of blood, gold, and splintered wood. Every kind of environment that the new Wolfensteins have come up with, from the obsidian and black marble halls of Death's Head Lair to the decadent lacquered wood recording studios in Nazi-controlled Los Angeles, have some kind of analogous building or sequence here in Youngblood. Aesthetically, it's like a greatest hits album, nothing you haven't heard before, but with a lineup of all your favorite hits, back to back to back, with maybe a remix or demo version of an ultra-classic lingering somewhere on disc 2. I like it fine that way. There's hardly a time where you're not looking at something eye-catchingly pretty. I say hardly because there are sewer levels here, awful ones, particularly awful because you only get flashlights on a few low-power weapons, and it is pitch dark otherwise. Fuck the sewer levels. Otherwise, the game is consistently impressive in how it does its lighting effects, presenting glorious afternoons with rays of powerful sunshine blowing drifts of smoke and dust, and a melancholy interplay of architecture that's impressive with architecture that's oppressive. It doesn't measure up to what Dishonored 2 did, but again, they're paced so differently in the mechanics that it makes sense to focus more on surface detail and overall impression than some kind of intensely intricate, realistic level design like the Clockwork Mansion. The center of the whole experience is killing Nazis. All mechanics, all aesthetics, must roll downhill towards that core goal of gameplay. What's kind of disappointing is that, in spite of 20 years of setting difference between the core trilogy and Youngblood, not much has changed. In the era between 1945 and 1960, all these buildings went up. A small but significant part of the plot is that the concrete used to make these structures was tainted. They were all supposed to fall down on their own eventually. So either that already happened, or it never did. It isn't really addressed, to my knowledge. But either way, it's odd to revisit a world that seems to have remained extremely stagnant through two decades of intense conflict. The Nazis have been losing around the world. Their empire is contracting in the lore. Should there not be some kind of civic reflection of this anxiety, either by going bigger or by flexing their sadism through architectural flourish? What the developers wanted, and what I largely wanted myself, was just more of the same of what New Order and New Colossus aesthetically delivered. Youngblood has become kind of a technical benchmark game. If you're building an RTX desktop build or investing in a powerful gaming laptop, it's one of those titles where maxing everything out is a point of pride, and the visuals reward however many hundreds of dollars spent to render them. The greatest amount of development effort in Youngblood went into positioning the game that way, by making its world glisten and sparkle as much as possible and making it shine in especially mathematically complicated ways, for people with expensive graphics cards. It is a huge success that way. I'm playing on nearly minimum settings, and it still looks incredible. It's just that this unwavering commitment to surface detail also represents a light abdication of the creative could-have-beens that the setting would have allowed for. Instead, it's a high-def tour of everything that worked before, without an ambition towards what might work next. A spin-off that doesn't spin so far off that it artistically commits them to one style or another if they revisit 1980 in a more mainline game. It does set the stage for other, stranger spin-offs in the future, though. When you finally find Blazkowicz at the bottom of Lab X, he's reluctant to go because the research he's doing there is so important. I mean, what? Apparently, BJ has seen through the veil between universes to an alternate reality where the Nazis never won World War II. This is important because in defeating Death's Head back in the New Order, he may have triggered a doomsday device that's killing the world they're in, regardless of whether they liberate that world from the Fourth Reich. I was incredibly disappointed in this twist because of how the series had taken some care in the past to differentiate itself from the Man in the High Castle book and series. Now, they're completely eliminating the most significant plot differences between the two franchises. It was always BJ's faith in humanity to liberate itself where the heart of the new series beat the strongest, from BJ's refusal to accept that the US had surrendered when he first woke up in the New Order, to the long-wrought process of overcoming his despair and rekindling his passion for revolution in the New Colossus. Having him distance himself from that with a sci-fi plot twist about alternate timelines is a great disservice to all the work done to make this timeline particularly vivid. Now, the games have always been playful with the idea of divergent realities, most notably on the pivoting on the idea of who you save and who you sacrifice in the New Order, but playful is all they were. There was no going back or altering anything. People who died were dead. America had definitively given up and lost. It was intensely focused on what kind of future to build from these ashes and not how to stop the fires past burning. Youngblood just teases these things, mostly, but it is the climactic revelation, so you can probably expect it to come up again in the franchise somewhere, somehow. I just can't overstate how little I care for it as a sci-fi trope, particularly with how the Marvel movies use time travel and alternate realities to set up seemingly dramatic resolutions to their plot lines and then simply walk them back so they don't have to stop selling merchandise for any of the imperiled heroes. Youngblood's status as a spin-off means it can have its own independent tone from the main games and be okay that way. It's not accountable to be consistent like a full sequel would be. Being a full-on action comedy without much in the way of emotional depth or narrative consequence works well enough to provide a foundation for a fun co-op game where you run the risk of players talking through all the cutscenes anyway. This twist worries me a lot, though, because of the consequences it could have on the franchise-wide storytelling. Would you be satisfied if BJ could go back and win the war in 1945 or whatever an alternate timeline plot would allow them to do? I wouldn't. Who BJ is as a character is inseparable from his weariness and pain, the same weariness of a world long under a fascist boot, a weariness gradually converted to the thrill of worldwide resistance, finally igniting from a spark into a wildfire. If it was the real world, sure, go and fix it so that the Nazis never won, because that's obviously better. But this isn't a world I live in, it is a story I am being told, and that kind of narrative erasure runs counter to the reasons I'm enjoying this story so much so far. I hope the story doesn't pivot in that direction, but I don't imagine they'd make this information a big deal climactic moment if they weren't at least considering it. The last revelation isn't as bad as the last boss. General Lothar is not just a terrible encounter, he's an encounter designed with seemingly no sympathy for the game's actual mechanical choices. It's the ammo problem that absolutely destroys any semblance of fun. The Lothar boss fight sits at the end of the entire Lab X sequence, which isn't technically a raid because it doesn't kick you back out into the main world if you lose. This sounds like a blessing, since you don't have to replay an hour's worth of content to get back to the end. You're conveniently checkpointed at the beginning of the two-stage boss fight. It's a multi-platform arena where an infinite number of large enemies spawn at the bottom level. There are turrets on the top level, and the boss can jetpack between the two levels with ease. He's also a massive, massive bullet sponge. The first time Nate and I wiped, we used about 3/4 of all our ammunition for all our various guns, and then checkpointed to the beginning of the fight again, with only that quarter of our ammo remaining. This time, we didn't even get very far before wiping again, and then we restarted with no ammunition, just a few clips for the basic pistol. So the limitless enemies who spawn on the bottom level are meant to be an ammo source, except that the game is balanced to require more ammunition to kill them than they refund on death. So even if you manage a solid run of group kills, melee kills, and lucky shots that let you get ahead on the ammo front, you're looking at maybe 50 ammo per gun. And that's not even going to slice into 10% of the total boss health. So how about the turrets, then? Well, in between phase 1 and 2 of the fight, you're required to go down below. Up top, turrets have poor ground coverage, so the bottom level can become swarming with top-level enemies, and no cover. Going down there is a death sentence, unless you go in guns blazing, which is where you'll need ammo. After 5 wipes, we reduce the difficulty to the minimum possible, and then we wiped 2 more times, and finally got him with a combination of turrets and pistols. You can make fun of how well I play games, a lot of people do, to the point where I routinely get comments explaining that anything I have to say about an action game is automatically invalid because I'm obviously complete shit at them. But Nate, at least, is the kind of person who always plays on hard, and he hated the boss fight even more than I did. It is utterly miserable to come to the climax of the game and be trapped in a perpetual scarcity loop unlike anything else in the entire rest of the game. As awful as the raid design can be, if you have to repeat the whole thing from start to finish, it was clearly intended to avoid just this scarcity situation. I wouldn't want to ever have to do Lab X again over again from the top, but surely there must have been a way to make it a genuine save state where you repeat the encounter with the loadout you had when first making the attempt. I don't usually complain at length about these sorts of things, but the Lothar fight was an hour of my life that I was quite unhappy to lose, and kind of emblematic of how even though Youngblood is willing to experiment with the rhythms and systems of the main Wolfenstein titles, it's not that interested in following those changes out to their ultimate conclusions. It was a sour way to end the game. On top of the story rolling back, the only genuinely surprising, shocking character death they managed to pull off. Nope. a happy ending, where the parents show up after the day's already saved, like a million other teen action comedies. Wolfenstein Youngblood has actually managed to pull off what game corporations have been threatening to do for a long time, to take a game about something as straightforward as killing Nazis and make it apolitical. The franchise's glee for killing Nazis is still there, but its failure to provide a humanistic and believable world in preference for making the game a platform for the delivery of undifferentiated content has made the whole experience as toothless as you can get. Why does BJ do what he does in The New Order and The New Colossus? Hope, desperation, revenge, a whole range of real options to choose from. I did what I did in Youngblood to make my numbers go up high enough that I could reach the credits roll. Nothing in the game's often remarkable visual art can overwhelm the fundamentally hollow, cynical design of the game Loops. Its choices are, I worry, a sounding board for how future Wolfenstein titles might skew away from character towards an amorphous, anonymous replayability, as if I haven't replayed New Order and New Colossus three times over exactly because they're so densely linear. Youngblood's hypothetical spin-off future is a Paris that is empty and stagnant. I just don't wish such a hypothetical future on Wolfenstein itself. Thanks for watching. I'd like to take a moment to thank by name some of the people who are currently donating $10 a month or more through the crowdfunding website Patreon to keep these videos rolling. People like Kale Perrion, Comfy Hat, Alex Hansen, Leo Neal, Ethan Cossett, Jean-Paul Quayler, Aaron Williams, Andrew Hartman, Zach Millington, Zoe Cheek, Eddie Burton, Carol Henderson, Daniel Phillips, Tyler Robinson, Jeremy McQuaid, Corey Bofill, Eli Bergmass, Dennis Clark, Jake Mays, Kumarin Vishan, Nobody, World War II Freak, Alexander Leister, Igor Babiuk, Lars Bracken, Morgan Mall, Ryan Hill, Julian Renault, Agandine, Jared Meyer, Jeno Shin, Stinson Sneed, Notum, Adam Alla, ICR 7, Thomas Culligan, Ali Mortimo, Brian Barrow, Sidonia, Massive Ron, Ron Gervais, James Condon, Greg, Chris Tekenton, Evan Eggers, Pavori, Vodka Blitz, Kirk Battle, Johnny Marsbar, Rusty Kelly, Jason Hine, Jeff Sang, Jason, Stephen Clovang, Eric Goose, Levi Thomas, Haste Guy, Hedgehog Kevin, Sean Sylvie, Doomed Sheridan, Jeremy Austin, Cody Patterson, Sophia Naylor, Alexander Smith, Konstantin Ivanov, Ali Hamoud, Franz Lafka, Devona Uparok, Jed Kirk, Logan Hickman, Danston, Tyson Cox, JRG123, Liam White, Zachary Leonard Roper, Wolf and White Van, Sergeant QQ, Trident, Penny Drake, Matthew Burns, Symmetry Master, 1MXW1, Aaron Dembski Borden, Matthias Campbell, Rogue Thrats, Keone Warby, Eli Youngs, Space Wizard 63, Arnie HD, Vivi, Maxwell Bohm, Thomas Vavasour, Emma vs. Dracula, Peter Grombach, Jay Calder, Tyler R. Smith, Alex McDonald, Tyler Park, Christopher Guile, Kevin Morris, Allison Sugar, Brianna Manassa, Mario Mendez, Dave, Alexander Cladworthy, Vadim Flax, Kyle Sims, Colin Stoltz, Nicholas, Quinn, Coolboy John, Ottavio Albanese, Ethan Hayes, Howard Knudsen, Quinn Hannah White, Carrie Hogue, Peter H., Reese Kittleson, John Little, Scrub Lord, Darren Jackson, Eric Jensen, Phil Harden, Elijah King, Baxter Jr., Max Barros, Patrick Galmond, Tyrone Lambert, Gabriel Holland, Simon Hasselow, Patrick Mills, Miesko Siaha, Colum TM, Bryn Gilbart, Drolox789, Deeb, Highland Fox, Well-Tempered Clavier, William Pabard, Quainin, Matthew Shyrock, Dragon Cobalt, Ricky Shields, Asbjorn Volkvalbjörn, Owen Tierle, Cold Beans, Bob Mitchum, Tyler King, Mike W., Stephen Lovedance, Benjamin, Ivan Echeveria, Selowick, Cobra, Adam N.H., Histoclop, Travis Houston, Alex Williams, William J. Gorman,
Marky Marcus Aurelius, Leighton Carden, James Henderson, Zachary Ziemba, Juju Beans, John Ciklofsky, Matthew Richard Teubner, Austin Matheson, Scott Muck, SG Response, Tiernan Garces, Christopher Askin, James Gray, Vitor Tumule, Derek Melanchon, Jared A. Hicks, Garrett Johnson, Han Jiping, Jacob Mwanish, Valeria, Psychedelic Cat, Max Cohen, Shieldwall, Leo Peril, Markleth, Tyler F., Piperman, William Tung, Conceited Axis, Bryn Davies, Lawrence Hurley, James Mosca, Simon Anderson, Victor Felton, S. Engvall, Jeffrey McIntyre, Marcin Zarad, Zachary Berent, Levi Whitley, Dakian Delamast, Mr. Mush, Nikolai, Elijah Nelson, Sam Bellmeyer, Byron Callan, Colin Guti, Eric Munson, Noah Kentrowitz, Tinfoil Pancakes, Max Pantoja, Maurice Desereau, Manu Weedman, Lo Beyonder, Gilosan, Vance Jordan Falls, Ralph Rainwater, Alexander Romanov, Piotr Kasperzik, Patrick McGranahan, Robot Ghost, Jeremy Saunders, Stephen Heim, Ryan Snyder, April, Jacob McMillan, Eric Joyner, Edward Clayton Andrews, Tim Dodds, Ian Glascock, Dylan Ball, C.E. Keane, Mr. Pigeon, L. Weasel, Veneral Herzog, Connor McLeod, Daniel Orns Christensen, Thomas Lee, me, Nemo Vandenbrink, the Nikiforovs, Ben Wellard, J.S., Nick, Greg Mirlis, Jordan Klein, Sky Jansen, Daniel Floyd, Mark Phillips, Andrew Tapp, Kevin Schaub, Matthew Sutton, Tizar Vicarian, David Carlson, Kissa, David Harpstreit, Matthew Mason, Josh, Obelisk Art History, Matthew Cassidy, Will Dobbins, Tom Rowerdink, Kyle Zahner, N.K. Jemison, Michael Atwell, Andrew Oplinger, I Cannot Fly, Dirk Warbrill, Nick Cole Hamilton, Galak, Brett Gialmo, Oscar Stangenberg, Lars Ingvar Anderson, Colin, Adam Howard, Dewey, Aurelian, Andrew Boissonneau, Pascal Murray, Alexander Sundin, Zach B., Lassilis, Toadheart, Thomas Witte, Casey Pioli, Hercules Johnson, The Soul James, Fergus Foley, Argus Swift, Ryan Van Dyke, Daniel Barsh, Cybot B., Kim Winson, Andreas Larson, Anthony Bardill, Sean, Philip Coffey, Brian Plockelman, Jesse Wilkison, Devin Fitzpatrick, Tim Marsh, Colin Bassnett, Jeanette N., Carl Gleason, Spooky Space Pook, Dios, Rich Stower, Adrian Comole, Nate Tenzar, Tom Painter, Simon Nierfolk, Sharif Kazemi, Jared Olszewski, Mr. Flacco, Eric Jepson, Dirk Warbrill, QRAX, Alex Zalato, The Bloke, Brandon Boat, Stephen Garrett Day, Sasha Ya, Peter Flink, Krimgi Schlepeps, and many others who are donated a lesser amount on the website Patreon. I really appreciate it, and thanks for watching.